Welcome students, this is second chapter of history, River Valley Civilization. Man's lifestyle changed significantly after he learned to use metals. He could now make sharper and more pointed tools with which he improved his skills. As bronze is harder than copper, bronze tools made the clearing of forests, the plowing of fields, and the digging of canals easier. Village settlements along river banks now became permanent. Agriculture produced surplus crops. This gave man more free time to improve his skills and manufacture goods to meet his growing needs. Exchange of these goods led to the growth of trade and trade centers, which in turn led to the rise of cities. The rise of cities in the Bronze Age ushered in the dawn of civilization. City life requires efficient administration, languages, scripts, and forms of worship and cultural expression. The sum total of such aspects of organized life in a society is called civilization. The earliest civilization developed along river valleys. This was because of the following reasons. Number one, the rivers provided an ample supply of water which could support large settlements. Number two, the lands near the rivers were fertile and various crops could be grown with ease. Number three, rivers were important means of communication because long roads did not exist. Let's repeat it again. The rivers provided an ample supply of water. That means there was abundance in supply of water so that the human society there could flourish with ease. Second, the lands near the rivers were fertile and various crops could be grown with ease. We already know that irrigation is a necessary thing for agriculture. So, the best kind of irrigation could be provided near river valleys. So, civilizations grew near river valleys as it was the most convenient place. Third, rivers were important means of communication because long roads did not exist. The first civilizations are hence called river valley civilizations as they developed along river valleys. They developed in Africa and Asia between 3500 BC and 2000 BC. Their sites are located in, number one, Mesopotamia, in the valley of the rivers Euphrates and Tigris. Number two, Egypt, in the valley of the river Nile. Three, Harappa and its surroundings, in the valley of the river Indus. Fourth, China, in the valley of the river Huanghe. Since we should be aware of all these things, we'll repeat it once again. The first civilization was Mesopotamian civilization in the valley of the rivers Euphrates and Tigris. Second was in Egypt, in the valley of the river Nile. Third was in Harappa, in the valley of the river Indus. Fourth was in China, in the valley of the river Huangpu. The Huangpu River is also called Yellow River. So now, let us study about the Mesopotamian civilization. So first point is, it developed in the valley of rivers Euphrates and Tigris. So, in ancient times, the land between the rivers Tigris and Euphrates, they are now in Iraq, was known as Mesopotamia, which means land between rivers. Remember this term? Mesopotamia means land between rivers. Mesopotamia included three regions: Sumer, Akkad, and Assyria. Around 3000 BC, some of the towns of Sumer emerged as powerful city-states. City-states are independent states, each consisting of a city and the area around it. So city-states means independent states, each consisting of a city and the area around it. Thus, Sumer became the seat of the earliest civilization in the world. So Sumer was the first civilization in the world. Next is, Sumer and Babylon became the seats of two great civilizations. After Sumerian civilization had declined, another great civilization, that is the Babylonian civilization, had emerged. We'll study about it, okay? So next point is, a Sumerian city consisted of a sacred area, a walled city, and an outer town. Let's study this. A Sumerian city usually consisted of a sacred area. Sacred area mostly is the religious place where usually prayers are offered. A walled city and an outer town. Walled city also is mostly where the king and the noblemen reside. And the outer town where the commoners or the common citizens of the civilization or the place reside. The sacred area consisted of the main temple, the storehouses, and the administrative buildings. So, I just told that sacred area mostly has temple or the worship places. Here we study, the sacred area consisted of the main temple, the storehouses, and the administrative buildings. Next point is, the king was the chief priest and lawgiver. So, the king, the priest, and the king's officials formed the highest class in society. They lived in the sacred area. The king made the laws and was also the chief priest. The middle class, mainly landowners, merchants, and craftsmen, lived within the walled city. The slaves, who were usually war captives, formed the lowest class. They lived in the outer town. Let's study this again. The king, the priest, and the king's officials formed the highest class in society, and they lived in the sacred area. the king made the laws and was also the chief priest. The middle class, that consisted of mainly the landowners, merchants, and craftsmen, lived within the walled city. The slaves, who were usually war captives, formed the lowest class. They lived in the outer town. War captives are people who are prisoners of war. When the enemy is defeated and the soldiers who have been captivated by the victorious side, they are called the war captives or prisoners of war. The next point is, the Sumerians worshipped forces of nature, often represented by the patron of gods of their cities. And they built ziggurats to their patron gods and believed in life after death. So, we should now read about the religious orientation of the Mesopotamian civilization. So, there is, the Sumerians were nature worshippers. Please keep this thing in mind, that the Sumerians were nature worshippers. That means they worshipped the forces of nature like rains, sun, wind, etc. The main temple of each city was built on top of a stepped pyramid called ziggurat. It was usually dedicated to the patron god, representing a natural phenomenon. The temple was the center of all economic, political, and social activities of the city. So we have, the main temple of each city was built on top of a stepped pyramid called ziggurat. So ziggurat was a stepped pyramid. It was usually dedicated to the patron god, representing a natural phenomenon. Like, we have Phoebus, who's called the sun god. Or, in Indian culture, we call Indra the rain god. So, the temple was the center of all economic, political, and social activities of the city. And Sumerians believed in life after death. Things of daily use were buried with the dead. Next is, agriculture, crafts, and trade were the chief means of livelihood. The Sumerians were mainly farmers. They were probably the first to grow wheat. To control the annual floods, they built dikes, dug wide canals, and created artificial reservoirs. They mastered skills such as metallurgy, pot making, cloth making, and glass making. We should read it again. The Sumerians were mainly farmers and probably the first people who grew wheat. And to control the annual floods, they built dikes. Dikes are small dams. Dug wide canals and created artificial reservoirs. They mastered skills such as metallurgy, pot making, cloth making, and glass making. The Sumerians were the world's first traders. They knew the use of money and devised a system of weights and measures. They were also the first to use wheeled transport, that is the carts we see on roads. They were first, the Sumerians were the first people to use the carts or to build the carts. Carts on roads and rafts on canals were the chief modes of transport. The discovery of Indus seals in Sumer and Sumerian seals in the Indus Valley suggests that there was overseas trade between the two civilizations. So we studied that Sumerians were traders. We also see evidence that the seals of Indus Valley civilization and the sea could be found in Sumer, and the Sumerian seals could be found in Indus Valley civilization. Next we have, they developed a cuneiform script and counted in 16. Let's study about the script first. The Sumerians were the first to develop a script for keeping records. They wrote with reed pens. Reed pens are made from the hard stems of a variety of tall grass. They're also called quills, Q-U-I-L-L-S, quills. So they wrote with reed pens on wet clay tablets and then baked the tablets. The letters were wedge-shaped and hence the script is called cuneiform. Cuneus is Latin for wedge. The clay tablets give us a lot of information about the life of the Sumerians. So what all they wrote on the clay tablets in the cuneiform script is the our source of study about the Mesopotamian civilization. Next, we study about their developments in mathematics and astronomy. The Sumerians counted using the sexagesimal system, that is, it was a numeral system with 60 as its base, that is, counting in 60. We still use this system for calculating time, as in, a minute has 60 seconds, an hour has 60 minutes, and so on. By observing the movements of the sun and the moon, the Sumerians calculated the length of the day. They divided the day into 24 hours and the sky into 12 parts, coinciding with the zodiac sign. The Sumerians devised a lunar calendar, that is, based on the movements of the moon. Their year fell just 11 days short of the solar year and provided fairly accurate information about the seasons. This was important to the people as most of them depended on agriculture. So let's repeat what all we have studied till now. The Mesopotamian civilization developed in the valley of rivers Euphrates and Tigris. In fact, Mesopotamia as a word means land between two rivers. Sumer and Babylon became the seeds of two great civilizations. A Sumerian city consisted of a sacred area, a walled city, and an outer town. The king was the chief priest and lawgiver. The Sumerians worshipped forces of nature, often represented by the patron of gods of their cities. They built ziggurats to their patron gods and believed in life after death. agriculture, crafts, and trade were the chief means of livelihood. They developed a cuneiform script and counted in 60s. They divided the day into 24 hours and the sky into 12 parts. They also created a lunar calendar. Next, we should study a little about the Babylonian civilization. We would study it very briefly. Babylonian civilization. A few centuries after the decline of the Sumerian civilization, another great civilization arose in Mesopotamia. This was the Babylonian civilization, covering both Sumer and Akkad. It was in many ways a continuation of the Sumerian civilization. Hammurabi was one of Babylon's greatest rulers. He ruled from 1792 BC to 1750 BC. He is remembered for his code of laws. The laws covered every aspect of life, and punishments were based on the principle of tit for tat. However, justice was in favor of the rich and the upper classes. So Babylonian civilization emerged after a few years of the decline of Sumerian civilization. It consisted or covered both Sumer and Akkad. Hammurabi was the greatest king of Babylonian civilization, and he is remembered for his code of laws. The code of laws covered every aspect of life, and punishments were based on the principle of tit for tat. However, it was in favor of the rich and the upper classes. So here are some of the pictures that can be associated with the architecture and crafts and trade of Mesopotamian civilization. Next, we have the assignment. You have to write the questions in your notebook, write the questions and the answers in your notebook. Question number one is, why did early civilizations flourish in river valleys? We have already discussed this. There were 3 points why early civilizations flourished in river valleys. Second is, what is the meaning of Mesopotamia? I've already mentioned it in the previous slide. Please write the answer. Question number third is, where did the Mesopotamian civilization develop? So this is first point that we covered in Mesopotamian civilization. Please write the answer.